those of you joining us by way of YouTube and Facebook, thank you for your patience. We're getting off to a little bit of a late start today, but God is still good and in control. Amen?
Amen.
Morning. Father in heaven, we worship you and praise you in Jesus' name this morning from the depths of our souls. From our hearts that are filled with praise, and from our lips that sing forth joyously to sing honor and glory to you. We worship you, we praise you, we celebrate you this morning for your goodness, your grace, and your mercy. Thank you for drawing us to this place this morning, that we may join together in unity of your Spirit, along with those that are joining us by way of the internet and the live feeds. Father, we pray for each of one that they, even in their distance, would sense a unity, a oneness, and the closeness of your Spirit as we worship together. Father, encourage and strengthen us in these moments. Guide us with your mighty hand into the way of truth. Help us to be aware of and open to the power of your presence that is among us today. And Father, may we continue to sing your praises, to share your word, and to give glory and honor to you. Lord, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Pleasant good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's good to see all of you here. It's good to see all of you here and there and everywhere. And we are glad that you have joined with us to worship this morning. Pleasant good day, and we trust that you will experience the unity and fellowship of the Spirit that is with us today. So, a pleasant welcome to you. And by the way, church, you're looking really good today.
How are you?
Thank you very much. We're a good looking bunch, aren't we? No matter what they say. Huh? Amen. It's great to be joining together and worship together this morning. This time we will have our scripture reading, which will be done responsibly. It will be on the screen. From Romans chapter 14, verses 1 through 13, I will read the parts that say leader. You will read in unison the parts that say all. I'm sorry, that say people. And we will all read together where it says all. Accept other believers who are weak in the faith, and don't argue with them about what they think is right or wrong.
For instance, one person believes it's all right to do anything, but another believer with a sensitive conscience believes only vegetables.
Those who feel free to eat anything must not look down on those who don't. And those who don't eat certain foods must not condemn those who do, for God has accepted them. Who are you to
condemn others as a servant?
Therefore, my servant is good, whether it is
sin
or all.
And with the Lord's help,
it is a sin to see to me who is approved. In the same way, some think one day is more holy than another day, while others think every day is alike. You should each be fully convinced that whichever day you choose is acceptable.
Those
for we don't live for ourselves or die for ourselves. If we live, it is to honor the Lord. And if we die, it is to honor the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. So let's stop condemning each other. Decide instead to live in such a way that you will not cause another believer to stumble and fall. This is God's word for us today. Praise the Lord. The title of our message this morning is Living to Honor God. The world in which we live today has become a place that is, how would you even describe the place we are living in today? It's a place that has become divided in many ways. It's a place that has become separated. It's a place that has people taking sides, one against the other. And we know that's very true, especially at this time of the year, and those of you that are here with me in Jamaica understand that clearly, especially in this coming week, as we have our national elections on Thursday. So all the orange people are out and about, maybe not so much because of COVID, but they're all over the TV. The green people are out, and those of us that don't know any better wear whichever color we want and hope nobody, you know, accuses us wrongly. And yet there is this picking sides with one another. And that's to be expected when it comes to the realm of politics. And we're not even going to go into what's going on up in that other place, because it's just pure miserableness, for lack of a better term. And we'll leave that one go, because it's just ugly, ugly, ugly. But the thing that is troubling, I think, in the midst of all of this, is that we are not being nice to one another. And I'm just not talking about the orange people against the green people. Those of you joining us from abroad, that's the colors of our two primary parties. The PNP is orange, the JLP is green. And they are very true to their colors. Much like in America, you have the red and the blue. And so we have this thing going on against one another in politics, but what I'm starting to see, even more and more in the midst of this division, is there's also becoming division amongst Christians, amongst those of us who should be sitting down together in unity and sharing in the love and the unity of the Spirit of the living Christ. And yet, what do we do? Boy, that person worked on the wrong end of the weekend. They eat the wrong food. They do the wrong things according to us. And yet we are trying to establish what we do, what we're doing, how we conduct ourselves and how we worship as superior to those other people. Because they don't worship God the way that we do. Shame on them. How dare they not worship the way that we do? What are they thinking? Because, you know, Jesus was a Quaker, didn't you know that? No, wait. What did Jesus say? You are my friends if you do whatsoever I command you. That's where we get the name friends. It's because our goal and our desire is to do what Jesus wants us to do and to be obedient to him. We also sing that song that says, what a friend we have in Jesus. So Jesus is obviously a Quaker. So why are these other people falling in line with us when we're right? Oh, but wait. The Baptists think that Jesus is a Baptist because, after all, John baptized him in the water of the Jordan River, so therefore Jesus must surely be a Baptist. And the Church of Christ, of course, well, how can you argue with that when it's the Church of Christ? I mean, we can go on down the line to every single one of them, and each one of us can claim a heritage and a history and a right to, I don't want to say brag, but yes I do, to brag about our connection back to Jesus. And that would be all and well if we could do that in a sense of understanding and getting along with each other and not wanting to be critical and condemnatory of those who are not like we are and those who think that they're doing things the right way when we know we're doing it the right way. Don't we? Paul, in this passage of Scripture, is trying to clarify some things that were obviously issues in the early church. You see, we think we've come so far in Christianity, in following Jesus, but in effect, we have come that far because the same problems that we're dealing with today, Paul was dealing with early followers of Jesus back in the first century. So it's nothing new. It's just taking different forms and shapes, and now there are multiple versions of Christianity, denominations or abominations or whatever you desire to call them, of different ways in which people have chosen to express and act out their relationship and their faith in Jesus Christ. Paul says here to begin with, he says, accept other believers who are weak in the faith and don't argue about what they think is right or wrong. Have you ever been in an argument? You thought I was going to continue, didn't you? Have you ever been in an argument? We've all been in arguments. Have you ever won an argument? And felt good about it? Have you ever been in an argument where there was no chance of winning? I honestly find in many cases, especially when we argue about our faith, our relationship with Christ and how we act out our relationship with Christ is an argument that is not going to be won by either party. Because both of us are pretty well set and convinced in the way that we believe. And therefore, it's very futile to argue amongst believers. And it really doesn't look good for us if there's someone else that is paying attention to who we are and what we're doing, and see these two Christians going at it with each other about something as simple as maybe what day of the week you worship on, or where you worship, or how you worship, or how you do certain things. Paul says, for example, some people think it's okay to eat anything, and some people think that you should only eat certain things. Then he says those who feel free to eat anything must not look down on those who don't. And those who don't eat certain foods must not look down on those who do. Sometimes I think when we talk about behavior of Christians, well, just behaviors in general, especially you see behaviors in our world today, it almost seems like we've gone back to kindergarten and first grade. Because we all know that as believers, we should live in unity with one another, and we should accept one another, and we should allow there to be freedom to worship Christ as long as we're worshiping Christ in spirit and in truth, as He has directed us to. But instead, we get into these little first-grade playground arguments. That's my ball. No, that's my ball. That ball's orange. No, that ball's red. The sky's green. No, the sky's blue. We argue about the most silly things when it comes to some of the most serious things, and things that really the outcome of the argument has no bearing upon time and eternity. And sometimes we just need to ask ourselves questions like this one. What difference will this make in the light of time and eternity? And if it won't, then why are we acting the way we are? Who are you, he says, to condemn someone else to serve? Their master will judge whether they stand or fall. And with the Lord's help, they will stand and receive His approval. It's not our place to be condemning and judging other people. It's not our place to feel that we are superior to other believers because we do such and such or don't do so and so. In the same way, Paul says, some people think that one day is more holy than any other day, while others think every day is alike. You should each be fully convinced that whichever day you choose is okay. Why would we quarrel over things like which day of the week we do what? In honesty, if that's what we believe, and that's what God has made us comfortable with, how are we to challenge what someone believes if it's not something that's going to cause them to fall into sin or to be disobedient to the Father in heaven? Remember, we got rid of those Ten Commandments and all the hundreds that went along with them to be granted freedom in Christ by the power of His Spirit that lives within us. And you know, people think freedom's okay as long as your freedom is the same as my freedom. Freedom is okay as long as we all get the same freedom. But the world doesn't work like that. And we have freedoms to be who God has called us to be. Paul also says in another place that we are to work out our salvation with fear and trembling before the Lord. How many times have we, remember we, I point one at you, three pointing back at me, so the we is all we, when we become so convinced of what we are doing is right, and our freedom is what's most important, we are then making it so that someone else's freedom is not assigned. And we are setting ourselves up as judges by simply thinking that we should enjoy more freedoms than other people. Or that our freedoms that we do enjoy are more important than those of other believers in Christ. When Paul, in fact, is saying here, you need to work out your salvation with fear and trembling, and you need to not be judging and condemning other people. When's the last time one of us sat down in fear and trembling before the Lord? When's the last time that we felt so convicted? There's a word you don't hear in Christianity much today. When have we felt so convicted by God's Spirit that it caused us to literally shake like the early Quakers did? By being overcome by the Spirit of God, telling us and encouraging us and helping us to understand how It doesn't matter, Paul says, by which method or which way that the gospel is preached. As long as the gospel of Christ is being preached, that's a good thing. And it's the same gospel, so therefore it doesn't matter who's preaching it or how they're preaching it or what methods they're using. As long as they've been worked out with fear and trembling before God and are in agreement with His Spirit and His Word. Full stop. But wait, God, you mean? Yes, I mean what I said, God says. I mean what I said. I mean that you need to stop judging others, condemning others, and looking at others differently because of the way in which they are expressing their salvation and their relationship with me. Now, of course, there are limits. One of the things some people don't want to understand or come to grips with about freedom is freedom doesn't mean freedom to do. And open-ended sentences. There's a lot of people that think, when you say freedom, that means, man, I'm free. And I can do whatever I want, and it doesn't matter because I have freedom. But freedom carries with it responsibility. And freedom carries with it boundaries within which that freedom can be expressed before it becomes offensive to someone else or to God Himself. And when we cross that line, we have crossed a line that puts us in the position that Paul is telling us to avoid in this passage of Scripture from the book of Romans. There are those who eat any kind of food to honor the Lord, and since they give thanks to God before eating, it's okay. And those who refuse to eat certain foods also want to please the Lord and give thanks to God, so that's okay too. For, in fact, Paul says, we don't live for ourselves. We as believers, we as Christians, we as those who are trying to be like Christ are not living for ourselves. And we also don't die for ourselves. If we live, and I read that and say, if we have the life of Christ in us, if we live, it's to honor the Lord. And if we die, it's to honor the Lord. So whether we live or die, we honor the Lord. In everything we do, we must honor the Lord. And we must live in the freedom that He allows us to have, and allow others to live in the freedom that He allows them to have, and not be jealous little third graders who think mommy gave somebody else more than I got. Or bigger beasts to pick. At one point we had some employees living in Jamaica, and at Easter time we would share out bun and cheese as a little token of our appreciation for our employees. Only thing is, some of them were just single and some of them, so we would try to share a large loaf of bun and a large tin of cheese, right? So at one point, there was some complaining about somebody got a bigger slice than I did. Who got the bigger half? You know what we did? The person who cut the cake had to give the next person the choice of which half they get. See, so if I want to cut and fudge a little more bigger on my side and take that side, that ain't going to work in that night. Because when I cut it, if I cut it a little bigger on one side, then the person that I'm sharing with has the right to take the bigger piece. So you know what they did? They made us get a rule. To measure and make sure that everybody was getting their hand. God God forbid somebody gets more than we did, of his blessing, of his Spirit's presence, or whatever he has. Let's get the measuring stick out. You know what God's going to say in that moment? Let's put that measuring stick back on you. And see how well you measure up to what's going on in this world. Christ died and rose again for this very purpose. To be Lord of both the living and of the dead. Because if Jesus is the Lord of the living, when we die, he is still our Lord and our Savior and the one that we will spend worshiping around the throne of God the Father for eternity. And he is the Lord of both the living and the dead. So Paul asks this question to the Romans. Why do you condemn another believer? Why do you look down on another believer? Remember, we all will stand before the judgment seat of God. And we will be judged on all of those things that we have done. And I think we can carry that to the next step and say we will be judged on who we have done. Because Jesus even tells us with the same measure that you measure another, I'm going to measure you. And so we better be careful how we're measuring other people because of measuring six when we turn back around on us. For the scriptures say, as surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bend to me, and every tongue will declare allegiance to God. My prayer on that one is that you've been in your knee before. You are forced to bend to me. After it's too late to acknowledge that Jesus is the Lord and Master and Savior of all. Because you have a choice of when you will bend your knee. You can either bend your knee now in obedience and service to Christ, or you can wait until after he returns, and then you will have the option but to bend your knee and acknowledge that what was presented to you as the truth really was the truth. And I don't know about you, but I'd rather take my chances. I'm taking that knee now. Paul goes on and says, yes, it is true each of us will give a personal account to God. So let's stop condemning each other, decide instead to live in such a way that you will not allow another believer to stumble and fall. So the conclusion of this passage of scripture comes down to the fact that we, in fact, if we are truly believers in Jesus, are united together in his Spirit by his presence with us. And we are part of one another. And we share a common faith, a common history. We may have to go back a little further. And others may have to go back a little further than us to find their history. But it all leads back to Jesus hanging on the cross of Calvary to die in our place for his sins, and to provide an option for us to receive eternal life. And if we exercise that option, then we become new creations, as we shared last week. Remember the new normal that we're to live every day as new creations. And because of that, we are linked together and united together in the Spirit of Christ. And even though we are different, can you imagine if we weren't? Can you imagine if we were all the same? What a boring world it would be, huh? But we all have our individual spirits. We each have
have our individual personal relationships with Christ. And we are responsible for how we live out that relationship with Christ. We're also responsible for how we respond and react and treat those who don't do it just the way we do. And because of that, we need to be cautious that we are not judging or condemning another believer because of the way that they worship. As long as they're worshiping Christ in spirit and truth, as long as they believe that salvation comes through the shed blood of Jesus on the cross of Calvary, that Jesus died and rose again for our sins, ascended into heaven, and is coming again. There's a lot of leeway after that for how people can choose to worship. And I personally, as a believer in Christ first, a Christian first, choose to live out my faith experience as a member of a body of Christ called the Friends or the Friends. Because that suits me. And I feel comfortable in this organization and the way that we believe. Not everybody feels the way about us and about Christ. And therefore, we must give them the freedom to worship Christ in the way that they choose to, on the day they choose to, doing the things they choose to do. And I think sometimes we need to celebrate the differences within the relationship with Christ that we have, and not be so narrow-minded to think that Jesus was a prophet. Because when Jesus was here, there was nothing else but Jesus. You couldn't be anything else but a follower of Jesus. And how about if we make that our role in this world today? That we become true followers of Jesus. And seek Him and His righteousness. And allow everything else to be added unto us. While those words are fresh in our hearts and minds, we'll enter into a time of quick communion, of silence before the Lord, in which we pause for a few moments to sit in silence, to focus our attention upon the presence of Christ among us, to listen to what the Spirit is speaking to us. And should the Spirit prompt us to share a word, a scripture, a thought, as He leads, we follow in this time of spiritual communion with our Spirit and God's Spirit. Spirit of the living God. Fall fresh upon us this day. Present to us the truth of the gospel. Encourage and strengthen us in these times with an awareness of the power of your presence among us. Father, we know very well that a house divided against itself cannot stand. And the body of believers cannot be effective as witnesses if they are divided against one another because of which day they worship or what food they do or don't eat, or whether they baptize or don't, or how they baptize. In Jesus' prayer before he was crucified, one of the main things that he prayed for was that we, meaning those of his followers, would be one. Even in the same way that Jesus and the Father are one, that the Spirit and the Son and the Father are one. Father, may we live in unity. May we live in oneness in your Spirit as your followers, as believers in Jesus. May we put aside petty differences. And may we celebrate the things we share in common, that Jesus Christ is the Savior. And that we can have a personal relationship with God through Jesus the Son, led and directed by the Holy Spirit. Father, grant us the willingness to live in unity and strength and power as those who follow you. We call ourselves Christ-like. Father, this morning our hearts are reaching out to those who are going through difficult times in these days. We think of those who have experienced loss and grief and are grieving in these moments. Father, we think of those who are not well themselves and feeling ill and not able to be doing what they want to do. We think of those that are suffering with medical conditions that prevent them from being as active as they would like. Father, we pray for any that would be suffering from the coronavirus and recovering from this illness. And Father, we pray for those that simply need a touch of your Spirit this morning and encourage and strengthen them in their life and the challenges they face and the circumstances and situations they find themselves in, even in these moments. Father, we pray for our nation, Jamaica, in these days leading up to the elections, that peace would prevail, that there would be an awareness that even though there are two different parties contesting races, that we are one people living in one country as Jamaicans, no matter where we're from or what our background is, and that there would be a sense of uniting together for the common good. Father, we pray for the events that are happening in our world. Pray for those that are recovering from hurricanes and storms and tornadoes, fires, and all kinds of things. For those that are suffering led by your Spirit. Father, we pray for all the churches that are gathering across the world today, those that are gathering on different days, those that are proclaiming the name of Christ in whatever form it may be, that you would draw us together in a sense of unity and oneness, that there would be a bond of love and of your Spirit that could not be broken, but that would in fact tie us and bind us together with cords of your love and your Spirit's presence. Guide us, keep us safe, protect us, bless us with your presence, grant to us the desires of our hearts, may the needs of our lives be met, and may we continually have a word of the Lord in our heart and a song on our lips and a proclamation that Jesus Christ is Lord, shouting from the rooftops for all to hear and all to be changed, challenged, transformed by an encounter with Jesus Christ. Grant your blessing to us in these closing moments and as we prepare to leave from this place. To be guiding and our blessing in Jesus' name. Amen. Just a couple of brief announcements to share with you this morning. Notice an announcement. Prayer meetings on Zoom Wednesday evenings at 8 p.m. for those that would desire to join with us for a time of sharing our needs and concerns and just a little bit of sharing what's going on and fellowshipping together since we don't get a lot of chance to do that. The link will be sent out through the WhatsApp group. If you don't get it that way, let me know and I can make sure that you can see that. And we will continue to have our prayer time at 8 p.m. on Wednesdays. And then for those not able to be in worship and desire to give through online giving in Jamaica, the information is presented on the screen. For those that are here this morning, even though we are not collecting, offering by passing the bags, the offering bag is basket at the back of the church. And we encourage you to continue to support the church. If you are joining us from abroad and would like to support our ministry here at Orbiton, if you would reach out to me through a private message, an email, or in some other way, I would be glad to share options with you for using PayPal or Cash App or check or other possibilities to support the ministry here. If you want to give, we'll find a way to receive. Amen? I do want to share just a personal note in case anyone has not heard. I try to reach everyone individually, but we do extend our sympathies to David and Christine in the passing of Virginia this morning. And our hearts are saddened for this loss, but our loss is Heaven's gain, and she is rejoicing in the presence of the Father this morning. And we will be all we can to support the family in the coming days. So we're going to ask for all of us to just be very much in prayer for them at this time. And we'll be available. You're not hearing me? When you didn't want to hear what it said. What happened? This time we will join together as we are closing exercise and we stand with me, please. Typically, our format here is to join hands around the auditorium, but we avoid that because of the COVID-19. So if you would just extend your arms out to one another and bless each other and share a long distance handshake and hug and how to do.
You can wave and say hi to everybody that's on Facebook this morning. Yes, there really are people here. I think the YouTube feed stopped a while ago.